Hello everyone, this is Christina Jang from ITDP and I'd like to welcome you to our webinar today. Before we begin, there are a couple of things to note. This webinar will be recorded and both the recording and PowerPoint will be available online on our website within 2 weeks. To interact with our host today, please submit questions through the Q&A function, which you can find at the top or the bottom of your Zoom screen. Please refrain from using the chat box. We also encourage you to enter questions in the Q&A function throughout the presentation, and I'll address them at the end. Again, thank you for joining us for our webinar today titled BRT Planning 701 Technology. This will be the last installment of the BRT Planning Guide webinar series, and today we will review key recommendations for ITS design for BRT operations for transport officials and public administrations. With the integration of smart city technologies and BRT systems, our hosts will discuss fleet monitoring and bus management systems, fare collection, and user information. Our presenters today are Giorgio Ambrosino and Saverio Gini. Giorgio and Saverio come to us from Memex, an Italian consulting engineering company that supports public authorities, mobility operators and agencies in ITS, urban passenger transport, city logistics, and smart cities. Giorgio is the technical director of Memex and for over 30 years has been involved in planning, design, implementation, operation, and evaluation of a wide number of projects related to transport services and innovative technological solutions. Saverio specializes in innovative solutions and services for public transport and mobility, such as fare collection systems, info systems, among others. Saverio's current work includes defining user needs, management of contracting phases, testing and support for system deployment and operations. Now, Giorgio and Saverio, I can hand off the screen to you and you can feel free to begin your presentation. Saverio and Giorgio, can you hear
me? Yes, thank you very much for the introduction. Sorry for...
No worries.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Great. Yes, I can see your screen.
Welcome to all the participants to this webinar. Some time ago, we have been asked by ITDP to contribute to Chapter 90 of the BRT Planning Guide, the part dealing with ITS, which is the content of this presentation too. Before starting, we wish to acknowledge the other authors of the chapter, in particular Brendan Finn, to actively collaborate to the guide. Into details, the webinar will face the following contents. We start from the identification of the drawbacks of ITS market, then we will detail the main ITS system supporting BRT operation, and we will provide the key recommendation for their design and the selection of the most suitable solution among all the available ones. We will highlight the role of the feasibility study, which is seldom underestimated by the public authorities and the transport operator as basic starting point for the whole process. We will conclude with some recommendations related to the contract implementation and operation phases, and some final common sense consideration of what public authorities and transport operators should do. Actors for ITS implementation are basically public transport operators and agencies or public authorities from one side and the IT companies from the other side. ITS supports all the production cycle of public transport from planning to operation, from the assessment of service performance to the reporting, including data mining functionalities. ITS are a key factor to increase the quality of the service in terms of performance, reliability, to improve customer-oriented services, and to enable services interoperability. This is even more relevant for BRT, where the concept of integrated network, taking into account the corridors, but also the feeder services, is fundamental. Sometimes ITS providers show a lack in in-depth analysis of the requirements. It is often conflict with the needs to customize the products to the local needs, which are extremely differentiated in the public transport market. This can lead to underestimate the implementation timing and the required resources, in particular to guarantee the on-site supporting services to be provided by the contractor during the implementation phase. Moving to the opposite side, we should highlight that public authorities and transport operators often overestimate the impact of ITS adoption, supposing they will bring automatically cost reduction, decrease of staff, and simplification of operational processes. Actually, the real experience is somewhat different from the plans, as the achieved results are lower than expected targets, implementation time can be longer, and costs could not decrease, at least in the first period. This occurs when the objectives of ITS implementation are not clear, the requirements have not been specified, and poor attention has been allocated to define appropriate operational procedure for the management of the system and to evaluate the impact at organizational level. All these points and others must be part of the feasibility study. Here you can see the main ITS system supporting BRT operation and public transport operation in general. For each system, there are different solutions, both from the architecture and functional point of view, as no solution fits all the situation, but they need to be tailored to the local needs. The first one is the fleet monitoring system, or as you call it, bus management system, AVM or AVL. For us, all these terms are equivalent in this presentation. In our opinion, AVL is the key system in a BRT ITS scenario. You can see some example of control rooms. In the control room, other back office system, for example, the supervision coordination for the vehicle maintenance, can be integrated into the AVL workstation. The second is the fare collection or the ticketing system, and here you can see some technological solution of the main components of this system. The third one are the passenger information system, or road panels for the provision of real-time bus arrival, onboard panels, next stop, line direction, infotainment, and audio announcement, web portal, and apps. Then there are the system for improving safety, video cameras on the vehicle and into the station, and passenger comfort, Wi-Fi connection. Finally, the bus priority system, which links to the UTC system. Fleet monitoring and fare collection system play a key role for the improvement of quality and performance of BRT services. They must be approached with a common perspective, thinking about the whole public transport network, the BRT corridor plus the feeder services, as an integration. This is quite relevant because the implementation of the ITS for a BRT is seldom the first ITS implementation in the city, but this should not address just the BRT itself. AVL is the real core system, as it provides data for the operation of other systems, such as the fare collection system and the video monitoring, and it enables the assessment of the quality of the public transport service and the verification of the compliance with the prescription of the service contract, the data collection during the service operation, the assessment of the service performance, the reporting of achieved value of the contractual indicators. AVL can give an example of the complexity of ITS deployment process, where the issues strictly related to technologies the definition of interfaces and protocol for system integration, for example, or the system upgrading and evolution over time are a minor part. The process will begin with the design of the system. Design will cover from the identification of the needs and objectives to be achieved by ITS implementation to the user requirement analysis, from the definition of system specification to the benchmarking of technical solutions available on the market. The following phase is the contracting one, and it covers from the definition of tendering process in terms of action and timing to the elaboration of tender package, from the management of the call for tender to the evaluation and the negotiation phase. The following phase are the implementation and the operation of the system. They combine technical and non-technical issues, but the impact of operational procedure are very important for guarantee a successful implementation. You can think about the device installation, for example, and high performing operation. For example, the management procedure of the system and the system monitoring. Now we will identify some key choices in the design of each ITS, providing some recommendation for them. We start from the AVL system. AVL covers a wide set of functionalities. Some of them are managed real time, for example, the vehicle location and the fleet monitoring, the service control, the data generation for users information services, the data events collection. Some other are managed offline, such as the assessment of the quality performance, the reporting of achieved values of the performance indicator, and the feedbacks to the planning. Depending on the feature of the services, for example, the delay or the timing coverage, and on the primary objective the authorities and transport operator want to achieve, the priority between real-time and offline functionalities can differ. This is reflected into different technical solutions, but also into different operational scenarios. If the AVL implementation aims to provide the real-time information services, a dedicated control room and the related infrastructure must be planned. On the contrary, if the aim is to assess the service performance and report them compared to the service contract, the monitoring and control activity can be carried out periodically based on the alerts notification sent by the system. In the integrated network scenario, the ongoing control activity can be dedicated to the corridors and the control by event can be suitable for the feeders or at least the peripheral services. Different organizational structure and operational procedure correspond to these scenarios. Other relevant points to be considered in the design of AVL system are the following ones. The first, very important, is the definition of integration scenarios with the service planning system, which include the specification of the protocol for data exchange. This means the data format, the detail of the communication modalities, and the setup of control tools for certifying that data exchange was fine or not in case of errors. The definition of procedure for the assignment of the vehicles to the planned services is the second. These functionalities can be based on different operational scenarios. The first one is automatic, and it consists of the transmission of the scheduled services to the onboard unit. The second is manual, and it can be carried out by the drivers when the service starts. The last is the assignment carried out by the operators from the control room, for example, for managing a vehicle replacement during the service operation. These three procedures can coexist in the same application. In this case, priority level must be assigned. For the service regulation, the scenarios related to the various irregular cases must be detailed in order to define what the system must do in each case. As last example of AVL functionality, We detail the reported functionalities, which can be dealt with two kind of indicators: the performance indicator of the services and the indicator for assessing the performance of the system. The first one can be differentiated into different subgroups: the indicators used by the transport operator for the service improvement, and the indicators required by the Transport Authority Agency for the management of the service contract. For both the indicators groups, the data to be collected must be defined, the statistical analysis to be guaranteed by the system, and finally, how the achieved value will be shared by the interested parties. AVL system has a key role in creating the repository of data collected during the service operation. This repository will enable cross-related data mining process to extract useful information for the service improvement, a definition of advanced marketed approach when the data coming from AVL is integrated with the data coming from other ITS system as the fare collection system. We have already introduced that AVL plays a key role in providing data for the management of service contract prescription, for the real-time operation of other public transport system, and for the operation of external city-level system. High-quality info depends on the high-quality performance of the AVL, which depends on technical performance, but also on operational procedure implemented for its operation. For example, if the vehicle has been assigned to a wrong scheduled service, the info will not be readable. On the same way, a vehicle with an onboard unit which does not work should be taken out of services, and this must be assured by the organization of the maintenance services. The quality of data is relevant for any passenger information system, in particular for the apps, as panels can be managed by and tested by line by line. Now we move to the passengers information systems. AVL generates the real-time estimation of arrivals of buses and next stops. These data are stored in the dedicated repository from where they can be accessed or sent to enable the production of info services on different devices platform, or road panels, SMS, app, or web portal. The provision of info services to end users can be considered as a chain. At the beginning, on the left side of the slide, there are the road data, the bus network, the bus stops location, the scheduled services, the real-time info on bus arrivals, the tariffs, and the tickets. At the end, at the right side of the slide, there are the added value services, which you can see in this slide. There is an example coming from an Italian experience. Static and dynamic information, public transport journey planning, payment of the services, news, and others. Added to this, app can support cross-sourcing functionalities such as customer questionnaire and surveys. Now we move to fare collection system, in particular to provide some key recommendations for the design of interoperability between the systems. The operational scenario of a fare collection system consists of the following steps: selling, validation, and control. The selling point can be differentiated by channels, web, app, ticket offices, by functionalities, emission and recharge, or only recharge, and by the presence or the lack of operators, for example, the automatic vending machine. All the data are collected at centralized level. In case of interoperability, a clearing module and related process are also operated. The operation of a fare collection system is not just a matter of technologies, as it involves the cooperation of different actors of the transit transport operator. The design should take into account a range of internal processes, the revision of fare and tickets, which could be simplified in order to make more evident to the users that the new system will facilitate them in accessing public transport, the definition of new target discount, the implementation of a marketing campaign, the integration of data from planning system, and the integration with the accounting system. In this slide, you can see the architectural and technological evolution of the fare collection systems over time. From magnetic and smart card support and car-centric architecture, 19 and 2000 years, to mobile application, EMV, QR code, and architecture based on cloud system, that is the current status of the art. Now, different tickets and payment modalities can coexist in the same application. A common platform or various platform selling channels provided by different providers are the alternative scenario to manage different tickets, support, and payment tools. In the second scenario, that is when various platforms are operated, we recommend to have a common repository for tickets and tariffs definition and updating. This repository will feed the different selling platform and collect the data about the tickets sold in a common format. Secondly, we like to design properly the data flow from the ticketing system to the accounting system in order to reduce the impact on the current practices and legacy system. Finally, the security elements of the system, for example, the security keys in a case of a smart card ticketing system, must not be in the hands of the provider and not implemented in the software code. In particular, this recommendation is relevant for interoperable ticket systems. In this case, the security elements must be shared by all the operators or by a third party organization, for example, the municipality or the Metropolitan Regional Authority. In case of interoperable system, specific recommendation must be considered. The definition of the commercial rules among the actors, the processing rules of the tickets from emission, selling to the validation, the identification of data which can be shared and the data which cannot be shared, and the definition of the clearing rules. We move now to the integration with the city system. The first example is the priority system. The main choices to be faced in the design of the priority system are the definition of the architecture of the system, which could be centralized or decentralized, the definition of the priority rules, the priority must be given to the bus always or just when the bus is delayed, the technological solution. We have basically three different scenarios: the installation of sensors on the road, the direct communication between the bus and the traffic light, and the transmission of commands for the traffic lights from the central system of the AVL system to the central system of the UTC. Here you can see a simplified architecture for the management of bus priority through the communication between UTC and AVL central system. You can see in this slide the detailed information involved in this communication. As last example, we focus on MaaS, mobility as a service, as integration of public transport data services into a broader smart city initiative. Public transport data and services are the main and required building block for any MaaS initiative. Public transport stakeholders must be in the core group of MaaS promoter rather to be considered just a data provider for the MaaS. Once detailed the recommendation for the design of the key ITS for BRT, we focus on the feasibility study as basic point to start the design process of the system. The feasibility study is the precondition to carry out the benchmarking analysis of the solution and the detailed specification of the system architecture and functionalities. The first action of the feasibility study is the identification of the objective the public authority and transport operator want to achieve through the implementation of ITS. Then the stakeholder involved must be identified and their needs, role, and responsibilities too. The definition of use cases is required to define the systems and functionalities, the architecture, and the technical requirements. In parallel, the analysis should focus on understanding the impact of the system implementation and operation in terms of staff structure, number of resources, allocated responsibilities, and daily working procedures. Based on technical and operational elements of the design, an economical analysis will be drawn, both for investment as for the operation cost. The cost-benefit analysis must take into account all the economical factors, not only the investment cost. Staff cost must consider the efforts for the design and the procurement phase. On the other side, the benefit must be estimated in a realistic way, taking into account the result achieved in similar condition and the effects over time. We move now to the contracting phase. The contracting of the system usually needs a call for tender. The procurement is the link between the work carried out at feasibility level and the realization, structuring in a formal way all the work carried out in the design and setting the required ground to manage the realization of the system. Approaching the procurement process, we recommend not to look for a large price reduction as a result of the procurement process. If well done, the feasibility study should generate a realistic estimation of the cost of the system. This means that the price factor should enter in the game only in case of comparable technical value of the bid offer. This needs to be reflected by the value of the awarding criteria. The second recommendation is not to underestimate the time and the resources required to manage the procurement process and to consider it in the economical analysis of the feasibility study. The last recommendation is to prepare a strong coordination structure just from the early beginning of the procurement process. This mix of expertise is required to manage the call for the procurement process. And the mix includes technical, administrative, and legal background. The ITS can be contracted in two different ways, as a supply or as a service. In both the cases, the economical value of the tender should take into account the services the ITS contractor is required to provide during the implementation and during the operation of the system. Now, we are going to focus on some key article prescription of the tender specification and recommendation to define them. The realization plan should be drafted in the feasibility study and detailed in the tender specification. The realization should be divided into steps, where the first one is a prototype of the system, and the following ones are the extension up to cover the full system dimension. In this case, the term prototype we use means a first release of the system complete with all or the main at least functionalities, but reduced as dimension spatial coverage. For example, restricted to a first corridor of BRT. This approach is good both from the technical and the operational point of view. You can see on the slide the technical benefit listed, but also as base reference to define the payments. Each of the payments should be related to a measurable progress achievement, a phase of the realization plan. The phase should be detailed in terms of required activities, installed component and system functionalities, and in terms of the target value of the performance indicators to be achieved in each phase. The payment should occur once the verification of each realization phase is successful. This approach will enable the public authority and transport operator to apply penalty in case of delay or lack of compliance for each realization phase. This approach can be used also as technical motivation for the termination of the contract. For example, when the delays for the achievement of a phase became longer than a maximum time period established by the contract. Moving to the implementation, the installation of onboard devices is seldom underestimated. On the contrary, its high quality from the technical and operational point of view is a key factor to operate the system efficiently and to achieve the expected target of performance. As you can see from the slide, it is quite an invasive process, and you have also to take into account that the bus needs to be taken out of services for the installation. We suggest that the required guidelines for installing the device will be included as technical specification in the tender package. This means to include the technical and operational requirements, the indication of international and national standard to be followed, to indicate the number of the vehicle available for installation each day, and the time of the availability of the vehicle. This information are required by the contract to propose an effective and realistic time plan for the installation. For managing the installation, we suggest to divide the fleets into homogeneous group of buses and to ask for the technical specification for the installation of each group. Once the first bus of each group has been installed and verified, the as-built documentation should be produced by the contractor as baseline for the installation of the other buses of the same group. We already indicated that the verification should test each implementation phase. A final verification will follow at the end of the implementation to set the final acceptance of the system. The verification process should be structured into three steps. The first one is the technical verification. This means the check of the installation from the technical and operational point of view. The second is the functional verification for each scenario, for each functionalities, including the not regular scenario. The third is the performance verification, which is the repeated verification of the same functionalities over a time period. Here an insight to the performance verification, whose approach can be repeated during the operation of the system, for example, during the warranty period. It requires the definition of the procedure to collect data, to calculate the value of the performance indicator achieved in the operation of the system, and to compare this value with the targets of the contract. If the value achieved are higher than the target value, the verification is fine. Otherwise, it must be repeated. If the value are extremely low than the targets, penalties can be applied to the warranty. The verification is repeated periodically during the warranty period. In this slide, you can see some example of performance indicator for the AVL system. Concluding our webinar, the awareness of the different factors impacting on design, implementation, and operation of ITS and the clear identification of needs and objectives are the leading milestone to be achieved in the decision process. The benchmarking with similar experience is a good support in action. This can be carried out not only sharing the good practices, but also the failure stories and the real performance achieved, to be disseminated, to be shared by the stakeholders beyond the marketing purpose. The feasibility study is the critical design phase where the needs and the target to be achieved are translated in technological choices, operational procedure, budget assessment, and commissioning action. And thank you to all. And with this, we conclude this presentation of the webinar. And we are available for question
or remarks,
question and answer session. Thanks.
Great. Thank you so much, Saverio. And we can open up the floor to the Q&A currently. As I mentioned, the function is either at the top or the bottom of your Zoom screen. We have one question here from ITDP. So we have some staff in our office who is watching this live right now, Saverio. So I'm going to take an analog question right here. Do you have some successful examples of ITS integration with other transport systems? So earlier in the presentation, you mentioned the importance of analyzing ITS beyond BRT, looking at other public transport. So if you could give some examples, that'd be great. Would you like me to
we understand. And we have some experience of integration of payment, integrated payment between public transport and other mobility services.
Like parking system.
Like a parking system, both in infrastructure or on the road. And sharing system, bike sharing, car sharing, and this experience is based on the use of the same smart card for accessing and paying all this bundle of services.
You know, the problem to integrate the different services are also problem of, for example, the VAT, for example, for public transport in some European country, the public transport operator pay different VAT of, for example, the parking system service operator. I make an example that on the ticket, for example, the public transport operator pay 10% of VAT and the parking operator, they pay 20%. That the problem is when you charge the card, there is a commercial strategy because you know that you should have a problem of which level of VAT you should apply. We have experience in a card for a small, medium European town that where, as Saverio say, with the same card, we pay different service. But some service you can pay, some service like by sharing or cash sharing, they allow to take the bike or the car only and not to pay the service.
And the recommendation that we provide in our presentation, in the session about the e-ticketing system, focusing on interoperability are coming directly from this experience because we was in charge of the definition of the smart card specification. Then all the recommendation we give about the need to understand the commercial rule between the actors, the processing rule for the tickets, and coming from this. And the example that Giorgio provided before, the VAT, is an example of what we name as a commercial rule to be defined between the among the actors.
Great, thank you, Saverio and Giorgio. Our next question here is from Richard. Which cities in North America have the best implemented AVL systems for BRT?
No, you know that we work sometimes in South America, and we know by TRB and so on the situation, that there are different providers that sometimes they are system integrator. And as you have seen in one of the first slide we show, in this field there is a little underestimate the problems of transport operator, that sometimes the risk is that you have a good location systems, but you don't the system is not able to face the problem related to the control and monitoring the public transport service or the BRT service.
Great, thank you. So I think those are all the questions we have for now, unless some other participants would like to add as we speak. Another question I had, since you are based in Italy, is many times we hear about the great fare integrated system in London with the Transport for London agency. Do you see that as a model that can be multiplied in other cities and perhaps outside of Europe as well?
Yeah, you know that we have two different rules. The system, aerial systems on the ITS should be a different view from the PTA, the Public Transport Authority, and the PTO, that is the public transport operator. There is a huge transit data that collected by the system. We should have from the PTA the capacity of analyzing this data, that this means due to that, as you saw in the slide, this ITS system, especially AVL system, is managed by the transport operator. We should insert in the contract the obligation to provide the transit data to the public transport agency, and the public transport agent should have the tools and capability to analyze the results of the service.
And just to come into your last question about, if you understand correctly, the transferability of the experience of integrated payment ticket operated by Transport for London. We think that this experience is strictly related to a particular context that is London, that of course can be replicated in other North American city, but it must be limited to this kind of contest, because for example now in Europe there is a fashion to replicate some of the functionalities that are operated in London, also in contexts which are extremely different. For example, large cities, but not metropolitan ones, or medium-sized cities.
Yeah.
And we know from our experience and the information we have that the experience of London is very, very specific in terms of investment cost.
Yeah, you know, very, very expensive. And, yeah. No, sorry.
And then it could be replicated, but taking into account similar content, yeah. Contest.
And you know, the last things that as you could have seen from the presentation, you don't forget the timing. Because the experience of London born more than 10 years ago with a large, huge investment, that, for example, you know that in Europe there are only 21 town that are more than 1 million of inhabitants, and 2,000 towns that have less 200,000 inhabitants. That this means the contests are completely different, and this is was the our suggestion that there is not one model that fit all the different town. We should have good feasibility study, because with the technology you know whether you start, but could be you don't know whether you end the project.
And finally, London can be considered, despite the dimension of the context, a good example of what we have shown in the presentation, that is the evolution of the ticketing system over time. Because as Giorgio mentioned before, the experience in London start with the smart card, the Oyster card, and then over time, they build on the previous smart card experience, adding new services and moving from the card-centric architecture to the more recent cloud system and NFC and the MV payment. And this, for us, is a good opportunity to highlight that in general, smart card system that can be considered now quite, let's say, traditional, are a good opportunity to set up all the supporting conditions that now that can be defined and implemented for supporting the future evolution of the system, of the ticket system over time. So the smart card system is a good way for an operator to approach the problems and the critical factor that could be related to the implementation of an ticketing system, and to prepare the scale up to other functionalities, other payment tools.
Great, thank you so much for sharing your insights on that question. We have another question here. Does the ITS allow for disruptions such as temporary closure of roads for repair, or allow VIP guests, which is common in developing countries?
Could you repeat, because the connection was not fine. Could you repeat it?
Yes, of course. Does the ITS allow for disruption such as temporary closure of roads for repair, or allow VIP guests, which is common in developing countries?
Yes, we understand that this is a functionalities of AVR system, that is to manage the events like road closure and of the network, and to reschedule the services based on these events. From our experience, these kind of functionalities can be implemented in two different levels. There are two different approaches for this. These functionalities can be managed at the level of AVL system, or at the level of the planning, service planning system. And in general, the operators manage both of them. and the planning system is used to manage the events which occur for a long period, and the AVL system is managed for the temporary closure of the road.
Can I add some things? In general way, we talk about macro irregularity and micro irregularity. The macro irregularity is due to an accident on the road and on the lane and so on. The micro regularity is clearly the delay that you made, the bus made during the service. It's clearly the AVL system that all the buses are under control will help to solve the two level of irregularity. The micro irregularity is managed by more or less automatically, and the incidents on the road, that the macro irregularity, the AVL support the operator to make the right choice.
Great, thank you, Saverio. So this will conclude our webinar today, and I'd like to thank you, Giorgio and Saverio, again for putting together our presentation. For our attendees, as mentioned earlier, the recording and PowerPoint will be made available to you in a follow-up email. And then just to conclude, I'd also like to just thank our attendees for participating in our BRT Planning Guide webinar series. As you all know, the BRT Planning Guide is the most comprehensive resource for planning a BRT system. And in an effort to provide a more digestible and user-friendly way to navigate the guide, we held a webinar on each volume throughout 2018, which you can see on your screen here. We could not have completed this series without the continuous support and interest from viewers like you, and we'd like to thank you again for your incredible insights and participation. So Giorgio and Saverio, thank you so much again for holding our last installment, BRT Planning 701 ITS, and that will conclude our webinar today. Thank you to our attendees again, and we hope to see you online in 2019.
Thank you to all and to the attendees.
Great. Thank you. Take care now.